بكلمات ربها وكتبه وكانت من القانتين.
In the name of Allah, the most beneficent, the most merciful, we beseech Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to send his blessings on the noblest of mankind, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his household and those who thread his path till the day of resurrection. Welcome once again, viewers. It's your interesting program, The Virtuous Woman, the program, our program, your program. The one you've always waited so long to hear whenever it's time for Sahur. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept this from us as an act of ibadah. I'm your host for today, Olagmuju Bushro. And the topic to be discussed today is one that requires much attention, that requires rapt attention, and requires your body and soul to be together. Today we are going to be talking about fulfillment of promise. I'm sure you just echoed that topic again, fulfillment of promise, obviously, yes. Like I always say that Islam is a comprehensive religion. It talks about everything and anything at all. So it means that fulfillment of promise is a topic that will not go out of sight without being talked about. But before I introduce you to our honorable guest in the house, let's go for a short break.
إن المسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات والقانتين والقانتات والصادقين والصادقات والصابرين والصابرين والصابرات والخاشعين والخاشعات والمتصدقين والمتصدقات والصائمين والصائمات والحافظين فروجهم والحافظات والذاكرين الله كثيرا والذاكرات أعد الله لهم مغفرة وأجرا عظيما.
Welcome back, viewers at home. I am Olagmuju Bushro, and to run the show with me today, I have with me Haji Akudro Mahmoud. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
So today the topic is fulfillment of promise. How exactly do we approach this topic? Where do we start from?
Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen wa salatu wa salam ala ashrafil mursaleen sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim. Our praise is due to Allah, may his peace and blessings be on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his household, and all those who follow the path to the day of reckoning. Fulfillment of promise simply involves respecting one's undertaking. As a Muslim, if you undertake a thing, you should respect it. That is the demand of Islam. If one enters into any contract, one must be able to honor it to the last. Our own case in the area of fulfillment of promise is not just it's a promise by mouth. It has to be all-involving. That is, when you promise, you ensure that it's something you can fulfill. Okay. Don't promise what you cannot fulfill. Because at the end of the day, it will amount to breach of promise. And that is a sinful act in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To ensure that we fulfill our promises always, Allah ta'ala enjoins us in a number of verses of the Quran on the need for us to fulfill our promise. One of such verses is Surah Al-Isra, chapter 17, verse 34. Right. Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Wa awfu bil aad, inna la'ada kana mas'oola. That is, fulfill every covenant, because you'll be called to account for it. That tells us that the issue of fulfillment of promise transcends beyond this world.
Okay.
as a Muslim, just like we are going to account for all our actions, our area of giving promise is part of those things that will be questioned, what will be questioned about in the year after. And once you remember this, it's very important that if you want to make promise, make sure it's something you can fulfill. It's something, if you want to make an oath, make sure it's the time, is the oath that you'll be able to redeem.
Okay.
Don't just open mouth and at the end of the day, don't just open your mouth and promise. Then within your heart, you know you can't fulfill that promise. Islam doesn't allow that such promise. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cautions us that you should remember that it will be questioned about in the year after. That you'll be called to account for every promise you make. Then also in Surah An-Nahl, chapter 16, verse 91, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Wa'afu bi'adillah idha ahadtum. That is, fulfill the covenant of Allah when you make one. As a Muslim, we may find ourselves in a situation where we feel, maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has done this for me. I want to show my appreciation to by Allah. Promising I will do this, I will do that. When you promise you will do something for Allah, maybe you want to fast for a particular favor He has bestowed on you. You have to ensure you observe that fast. Because it's a promise you have made to Allah. And that's why Allah says, when you make any promise unto Him, you must ensure you fulfill it. Then we don't say what we cannot do, because we have also been cautioned in verse 2 to 3 of Surah As-Saff.
All right.
When Allah says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, lima taquluna ma la taf'alun, kabura maqtan inda Allahi, and taqulu ma la taf'alun. That, oh, you who believe, why do you say that which you do not do? For it's most grievous sin in the sight of Allah that you say that which you do not do. That is to tell us that we don't utter such promises that we know we don't have the capability of fulfilling. So that is to tell us that before you make promise, you have to think deeply, make sure it's something within your capability, something you can do, you can accomplish. Then thirdly, it must be on legitimate matters. When you want to make promise, it must be promise on something that is legitimate, something that is right. It must concern the truth. It must not be on sinful act.
Alright,
you don't promise on sinful act or something that will amount to disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Okay.
For instance, maybe you are in courtship with somebody,
alright,
and you've promised that you marry each other at the end of the day.
Okay.
If it happens that this partner becomes wayward, becomes a drunkard, leaves the path of Islam and start doing all prohibiting acts.
Right.
As a Muslim sister, you have to be alert. You have to think deeply before
you continue with such relationship. Okay.
Because truly you've made promise to each other. But here is your partner, your to-be husband.
Becoming fully
engrossed in sin, and yet you still wish to fulfill that promise.
Okay.
No, it is not that type of promise that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about.
Okay.
Because this already involves sinful acts. Mm. So at such point, you have to break your promise. Because it's no more in obedience to Allah. Rather, it is in disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Okay. I'm sorry. I think at this point, I really like the aspect where you're talking about not saying something you cannot do. I think before we proceed, we should address the mothers at home now. I'm aware of mamas who always tell their children that, don't worry, I'll buy you biscuits and I'm coming back. Or, okay, you want to go out with me? Tomorrow I'll take you out. Such statements, are they also regarded as promises?
Yes, of course. They are promises.
Okay.
And that involves between parents and children. Sorry. Whenever we promise our children,
okay,
we must ensure we fulfill it. Mm-hmm. That is the demand of Al-Islam.
Right.
That is, you don't say something you know you will not buy. You don't promise him or her anything you will not bring home at the end of the day. Because if that continues, the child will grow to believe that my mother doesn't fulfill her promises. And my mommy will always lie that she will buy this, she will buy that. And at the end of the day, she will not buy it. So in a way, if we are not careful, the child will lie, we learn to be an untruthful child as the time goes on, because we are teaching him or her how to tell lies already.
Okay.
So because there was even an instance in the life of the Prophet
Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam
that Aisha invited a boy to come and take. Mm-hmm. And when the boy came, Aisha gave him dates.
Okay.
The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, if you have called him without giving him anything, it would have amounted to telling lies. So that is to say that whenever we promise our younger ones at home,
we should live up to the promise.
Live up to the promise, yes.
Okay.
Now, another area that is important in the issue of fulfillment of promise is our ability to remember our promises. Is a very important factor.
That's important.
When it comes to keeping promise, we have to be able to remember whatever promise we give to people, and at the same time, we must follow promise up with determination. If there is no determination of mind, then it may be difficult for us to fulfill our promise.
Okay.
Because on the first aspect, that is on memory, being conscious of what we promise is a very important factor, because even it happened to the first man on the earth, that was Adam, alayhi salam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken promise from him that he will not go near the forbidden tree.
That's true.
But along the way, he became a prey to weakness and forgetfulness within some few days. And he went ahead to break his promise. What really happened to him was forgetfulness, a kind of memory that was not awake. And as a result, he offended Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we should take lesson from this, that whenever we promise, we should ensure we follow up our promise with a conscious mind, a wakeful heart. Is very important. And at the same time, a strong will to ensure that promise is finally accomplished. In the process of fulfilling promises, there is no doubt we come across some inconveniences, such that we have to make sacrifices
along
the way. We have to make sacrifices. So if there is strong determination, we actually follow it up till the end.
All right.
So these two factors are very important when we give promises.
All right, Haji Akudro, there's something I would want you to touch on that will probably be after the break. There's this common attitude of politicians making promises, and I think we are always at the receiving end because we are the one who is being promised, and at the end of the day they really don't meet up to those promises. Sometimes it might not even be politicians at the higher level, it could be probably somebody taking up a post at the local level, or probably in the university where you find yourself or something. And most times we just listen to those empty promises. They have been like that for so many times, and it's just so repeated. So viewers at home, if you're just joining us, it is The Virtuous Woman, and the topic for today, like I said earlier, is fulfillment of promise. Join us right after this break.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim.
Qad aflaha al-mu'minun.
الذين هم في صلاتهم خاشعون والذين هم عن اللغو معرضون والذين هم للزكاة فاعلون والذين هم لفروجهم حافظون إلا على أزواجهم أو ما ملكت أيمانهم فإنهم غير ملومين فمن ابتغى وراء ذلك فأولئك هم العادون والذين هم لأماناتهم وعهدهم راعون والذين هم على صلواتهم يحافظون أولئك هم الوارثون الذين يرثون الفردوس هم فيها خالدون.
Welcome aboard, viewers at home. It's time out with Haji Akudro Mahmood on the topic fulfillment of promise. So Haji, before we went for the break, I was saying something about making empty promises and those at the receiving end. How do we corroborate the two?
As believers, as Muslims, it's not right to give, to make empty promises. Because Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, apart from those Quranic verses we have mentioned earlier, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam cautioned us by making us realize that it's a sign of hypocrisy for anybody to give promise and not fulfilling it. He says in one of his ahadith that there are three signs of an hypocrite. That when he talks, he tells lies. When he makes promises, he does not fulfill it, he breaks it. And when he is entrusted, he betrays the trust. So from this hadith, it becomes very clear that as a Muslim, as somebody that knows that everything does not end here in this world, we'll meet with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the hereafter to give account of all our actions, of all our deeds, then we must be conscious every time that whatever promise we give to people, we should be able to fulfill it. So as leaders, as bosses in offices, as politicians, don't make promise that you cannot fulfill.
That's
because doing it amounts to deceiving people. And Islam is against deception. We must not deceive others. A fulfillment of a promise is a kind of human right. It's the right of other people that is binding on us. And it's an obligatory duty on us to discharge the right. So as a Muslim or any human being on the surface of the earth, you must always keep it in mind that when you make promise, you fulfill it. The fact that you want to attend a post does not mean you have to tell lies before attending such positions. Because if that happens, the implication is next time you come up and campaign, then people should not vote for you.
You should lost trust of
because
the
implication is they should not have trust in you again. You have created a kind of mistrust already. And when you come up and say you want to campaign, I want them to vote for you again. If people are really thinking the way they should, then such candidates should never come up again. And even when they come up, they should not be voted for. That is the demand of Islam.
All right. Ma, please, can you take us through? I'm sure that in making a promise, Islam would have, I know that Islam is a very comprehensive religion and it talks about everything. I want our viewers at home to have a clearer understanding of the implication of breaking a promise. A party to the agreement made, is it permissible to change the terms of agreement? For instance, there's a business deal and I'm supposed to get about 50%, the both of us would have 50% share. And probably I didn't get up to that, or I have more responsibilities to take care of. can I decide to, since you are richer than I am, so I can decide to give you a 30 while I take 70, can a party to the agreement change the terms of promise?
Now, on that, it cannot just happen like that, that one of the parties will go ahead changing an agreement that was mutually taken by the two parties. If there is a necessity for that, that should be done by the two parties involved with understanding and trust. But in a situation where somebody will go in agreement or will promise somebody that maybe in business transactions, that maybe somebody borrows money from another person and promises to pay back the loan at a particular time. But within that person, as he was promising, he's having it behind in his mind that he won't pay back the loan. That is not accepted. That is a very sinful act in Islam. Because there is even an hadith that Prophet Hassan said, if anybody borrows money and have the intention of not paying back the money at the time of borrowing, that if the person dies in such a condition, that is the condition of not paying
back the debt,
the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will raise that person up, that person will meet Allah on the day of judgment as a thief. We can see the implication. So it is not right for anybody to go behind to change any agreement just because you feel the other person is richer than you do. No.
Not even the death of a party to the agreement can change it.
Not even the death. Okay. Not even the death of the other party can change it.
Okay.
Because there was even an instance in the life of the Muslims, the companions, that Prophet promised Jabir, he promised Jabir ibn Abdullah that when they come back from the a battle in Bahrain, that is going to give him so amount of spoils of war.
Okay.
But before Bahrain comes, the Prophet Islam died.
So
it was at the time of Abu Bakr that this battle came up. And Abu Bakr was aware that Prophet Islam promised some companions that he will give them money that comes out of the spoils of war from Bahrain. So at the end of the war, Abu Bakr announced that those who had promises from the Prophet on the Battle of Bahrain should come up and say such promises so that he could fulfill it for them. And this companion, Jabir ibn Abdullah, went to Abu Bakr and told him what the Prophet promised. And that was how the promise was fulfilled. So, and other areas where we need to be watchful of the promise we make involve the area of mahr. When a man promises to give a particular amount or gift as mahr, he should ensure he fulfills it. That case of promising an amount for mahr and having it in mind that you will not pay is not allowed in Islam, because Islam said in one hadith that if somebody promises to give his wife a mahr, that is dawah that is given to a woman in Islam, and at the end of the day he did not give the mahr because he really meant not fulfilling it, that such person will come on the day of judgment as a rapist. That is to make us know the implication of playing away or treating issues in Islam with levity.
Okay.
So we have to be very careful in anything we do. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala assist us.
Naam, jazakumullah khairan. I was just about asking, but you have already touched one or two implications of neglecting promises that we have made. Just in one or two sentences, can you tell us the benefits of keeping your promises, fulfilling your promises, in just about one or two sentences?
Now, alhamdulillah, I mean, when we fulfill our promise, we have an atmosphere of confidence. There will be trust. And peace and harmony will reign on the surface of the earth. And that is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually wants by creating man, that there should be harmony, there should be peaceful coexistence. So when we are able to fulfill our trust, then this mutual peace and harmony will reign, and the society will be free of deception.
Alright.
And there will be good relationship among mankind.
Talking of good relationship, I think our viewers at home, you will not say that I did promise there was going to be an interesting session and it didn't meet up to your expectation. I'm sure that on this session of fulfilling promises, you've had a very wonderful time. I do not doubt that. Same time, same station tomorrow. Join us again on The Virtuous Woman. I am Olagunji Bushra. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Today you become man and wife, fulfilling the sunnah as way of life. Today you find serenity, may your life be filled with sincerity. There is no happier day in your life than the virtue of being man and wife. There's joy without any end. Allah's blessing on this day does descend.